it all goes back to being 2 years old watching the Beatles on TV in 1964.
Oh yeah, I'll tell you something. I think you'll understand.
I was obsessed with them, and music's always been a major focal point of my life. I started running record stores when I was 16. I had discovered a specific store when I was about 14. It was a cool place. It was the place you could go to, that you'd hang out, and you met strangers. But you were all there because you loved music, and you turn each other on to stuff nobody had heard of or something new that was out. And I was 14 years old, and got to get a job. You know, I want to work in a record store because that's where my interest is. This guy had a store that he supplied the town with everything. It was like a mini mart of everything. He had a little counter, glass counter in the space like the store here. He had some records and cassettes and 8-tracks. I harassed the guy for a year. You got to hire me. I know what I'm doing. Trust me. Blah, 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 blah. Within 2 weeks of getting hired, he fired the whole crew. He was like, I don't need anybody. You're the only one who cares. You play the stuff, you rearrange, you're talking, you're selling. Everybody else stands there and just wants to talk and say that they work in a record store. When I went away to go to college, I came back about a year later to visit, and the record store was gone. And I went up and I said, Frank, what happened? He said, when you left, all the business left. I had my daughter run it for a while, but just nobody was coming in because nobody had the passion that you have for it. So I closed the store, and I was there's a long history with everything. Music is my life, so that's why I'm here.
Idea was that we just wanted to focus on music that wasn't being found in other record stores. I was, at the time we opened the store, I was usually spending about $100 to $200 a month mail ordering records, and I would go to the record stores in town and try to find them, and just wasn't able to, you know, just to find this music, because there's just, it's so easy to record stuff now, and there's so many people making amazing music now that it's kind of stupid to limit your scope to just what Spotify tells you is good. We have had a venue in the store since we started, and I've always really liked it because it, when we first opened, it was a way to advertise for the store. We didn't actually do any real advertising. We just had the shows. And so it was a way to get people into the store without really having to pay people for advertising. And so we would just do like a lot of social media stuff. And then as we did that, we just got like bigger and bigger shows, which was also cool. So we can live with that.
I mean, it's just kind of been a very long process. I guess kind of the incarnation or the birthing of it was just that I worked at a record store right out of high school when I first moved down to the city, and it was the best job I had. It didn't feel like work, very carefree. And then just over the years, working other jobs and kind of being over the whole thing, and having a lot of records that I needed to sell, and kind of getting tired of desperation to sell my records to other shops. It just kind of made sense to start my own shop and then sell records. There's so much music in the world that nobody listens to because everybody's like still looking for all their Beatles records. And that's not to say the Beatles aren't great, you know, but like how many musicians did the Beatles influence, you know, in like more of the artistic culture where they weren't constrained to making music for a label. The Beatles are like a different example, I guess, because they were so commercially successful that they pretty much got free rein to do whatever. But imagine if they had no rein, the kind of music that they would have created. So it's the philosophy is that for every Beatles record, I think there's like 10 other great records, you know, that people aren't listening to.
I got into hi-fi largely it was rebellion against my mother, kind of a messed up home life. Actually, I could escape into my music and didn't have much good equipment, just the cheap little record players. But my family owned one of the first video stores, the independent, just before the chain stores were around, and we had a amplifier and some good speakers that went with one of the video systems. We would sell the video system. We quit selling those, and I stole the system. I took the amplifier and the speakers home, and that was the beginning of it. Hooked up a tape deck to it and an old record player, and that was just the beginning. And I could escape into my music.
For years and years, I actually had a recording studio in my dad's house, and I couldn't afford the tube amplifier gear and all that stuff that I wanted. So then I, started getting tube stuff, because I had, back in the 90s, you had to have like tubes and all this because the digital medium didn't sound that great. So you needed all the things in the world to kind of warm it up and kind of get the right kind of saturation and all that. And so then I got into trying to make tube amps, didn't know how to do it. So I'd tear tube stuff apart that I could tear apart a lot and keep messing with it until I started making stuff, and then that sort of morphed me into being an audiophile. I always wanted to make them look more sculpted, very inspired by Art Deco stuff, trains, old cars. And so then I started making kind of avant-garde looking kind of crazy tube amps and all that, and got really into it. Like, that's all I could think about day and night.
I mean, I always loved music. Mostly my brother had the record collection initially. So that was always there, and occasionally I'd sneak in and listen to some records that my brother had. But the thing that really got me into music, and it was like many people, you know, you start to hit puberty and music becomes important along with lots of other things. My father, who passed away when I was very young, but he knew this guy named Jerry Way, and I forgot to bring the Jerry Way record, but they had a Jerry Way single. So he was like this local Westby, Wisconsin country singer. So he cut an independent 45, and apparently when I was like two, I really loved it. So we had the King of the Road 45, and I would play that over and over again. And according to my mom, somebody sat on it. I'm not sure I believe that.
In the early 2000s, something interesting happened. Everybody started switching these big systems, big volume speakers, and volume is in cubic volume, to the little micro systems or mini systems. Everything was going all digital, so you had the little speakers and a subwoofer. You could hide it around the room. So these sort of became superfluous. These were shoved off into back rooms and people's basements. These are JBL L112s. This was the home version of a studio monitor. These are the famous JBL L100s. I've got a set of L80s. And what happened on these, this little foam rubber ring around the woofer, these oxidize. And so these were all rotted out. And people said, hey, I have a blown woofer. And I was just, needs to be replaced. There's a way to tear these apart, replace the rubber, glue a new one in, and rebuild the speakers back to original specs. So the kind of speakers I could never afford as a kid, I couldn't even dream of owning these, I'm picking up for a couple of dollars, a $30 set of foam surrounds, and I'm good to go again. And it's just, it's been wonderful. And the same with the hardware. A lot of this stuff has gone out of production, and with just a little bit of cleaning on the potentiometers, the pots, or putting new capacitors in, fantastic sound out of them again.
I started, my first stereo was, my first record player was I think it was a Yamaha. It was made in the 80s.
So I figured Yamaha deserved a listen, and man, it really delivered. Yamaha audio, dynamite stereo, whether you go by the book or play it by you.
And I had that until I was in high school. And that thing, it wasn't anything special. It was just kind of a basic record player setup. And then as I got older, it goes to the fact that I've never really been into records for the sound quality. So I was never investing large amounts of money into, the fanciest cartridge and needle or anything like that.
What planet are you on, man? No, you gotta have both. You can't have crappy stereo. Because your records, which, you know, those are your prizes, you got to take care of them. When I was in the bands back in the 80s, with friends of mine, and I would go and I would use their instruments that were extremely expensive. They came over to my house. If I saw them heading towards my record collection, like, dude, what are you doing? No, don't touch it. I'll play it. I didn't want anybody touching it because it meant something to me. They were valuable to me. So it was special. And with a record player, you got to have something to take care of them, because if you play a crappy record player or a record, you're going to hurt the records. The stereo I've got here in the store is the stereo that I bought when I was in college. You know, I was kind of like, this is going to be my stereo for when I have an apartment and when I have a house and if I ever have a record store. So it all worked out pretty well.
Oh, man, I'm still such a novice with audio equipment. The best advice that I've ever heard given is, if it sounds good, like, don't mess with it. I really like the speakers that I'm running in here. They're Klipsch Herzies and they're version ones. No particular reason. They were just, someone custom cased them in the same wood that I sourced for the shop. So I've kind of tried to stick to that. Like, I wanted to have really nice turntables in the shop. So I had this guy in New Hampshire called Vinyl Nirvana building these restored Torrens turntables. It was a good excuse to, like, buy some nice turntables for myself, you know, starting a business and then get some cool speakers. But eventually, you know, I'd slowly like to invest and get like some really, really nice audio equipment.
The reason for horn speakers is that, well, they're all kind of inspired by old, like, 1930s theater systems, like late 20s, early 30s, up to like the 1960s. But really in those first bunch of years, because they only had 2 to 3 watt to 4 or 5 watt amplifiers to fill up a whole room. So they had to have speakers that were really efficient to, you know, because nowadays you can get 1,000 watt or 5,000 watt amp, and so you could just blast the speakers with them. But back then they didn't have that kind of power. So they had to come up with horn speakers and these really delicate drivers to fill up auditoriums with the sounds from movies when the first sound movies came out. And so there's a bunch of people over the years that got into making horn speakers, because they do have a really magical kind of big, beautiful sound when they're done, you know, when all the stars align and you just leave them alone, they sound great there.
The best thing you can have on a turntable, which I haven't seen in a very, very long time in anything that's affordable, is one that's adjustable with a strobe light, because then you can adjust the speed to make it run at exactly 33 and a third inches per second. And I think this does differentiate me from a lot of people. It's always been about the music. So I've always been a software fan as opposed to a hardware fan. And it's not because I don't want decent sounding systems, but you can spend a fortune buying a turntable and an amplifier and speakers and then not have enough money left over to buy records to play it on.
I like the sound of records. That's never really been my draw. I get people that like that more. I think it's more of a justification than it is an actual reason why people like it. And you can spend $200 and get stuff that sounds great. Our listening station turntables, we just got them yesterday. I'm so psyched on them. They're $130. They come with a headphone jack in the record player, and they come with the headphones. It's fantastic. Like, these companies are making stuff to make it easier to get decent quality for lower prices, which is really good. So, so for $200, you can get a really decent one, but stay away from Crosley's. They're garbage.
Todos os olhos do mundo na minha rua e longe. Olho o menino chegar, um filho lindo pra cuidar.
Favorite record, and why is it my favorite record?
My favorite record is Nod, and the album is called Infinity Machines. It is an hour and 20 minutes. It is one essentially long piece. It's broken into six parts. It is just epically heavy. And there's words, but they're mostly just like kind of a person speaking underneath the music, so it doesn't really mean anything. But the story that just the music tells is amazing, and it just builds the first, like, it's a three LP record, and it is, I went back and forth. I was like kind of, I held off on calling it my favorite record because everybody wants your favorite record to be Led Zeppelin 4 or Sgt. Pepper's or great records, but it's been 50 years. Like, it's time to find other records.
Paul and Linda McCartney's Ram is up there. Honestly, Tusk by Fleetwood Mac, that's up there. I think it's way better than Rumors, personally. You get all the angst from Lindsey Buckingham and Stevie Nicks, and then Christine McVie's songs are just like heavenly. I'm just going to say those two for now, for right now. Those are my favorite records. I haven't listened to either of them in a long time, but I don't know. They're just not atypical things that people talk about when they talk about the Beatles or talk about Fleetwood Mac, and I think they're better than anything else that those projects ever birthed. So, yeah.
Do you want to tell me what you have, like, your first record was and how you got on it?
Wow. First record.
So the first record I ever bought. Let's see if I can even find it now. Oh, okay. All right, that is. It was this record. Right here. Elton John's Caribou. I was justified when I was five. Raising Cain, I spit in your eye. Time to change and now the war gets back. Which was maybe not the best place to start, although it's a good album. It's not a great album, right? It's all nice and pink in there, in the inside. I adore Elton John. He's not maybe the most consistent of artists, but when he's good, he's really good, and he's really good at pop singles. This was a little different, and it kind of took me briefly down progressive rock road. to the point where, I bought really good progressive rock albums like Dark Side of the Moon, Animals, and Wish You Were Here. And it also led me down the really, really bad, cheesy Emerson, Lincoln, Palmer route and that type of thing. And I went and bought it among with other records over the years. And that was kind of where I started. And, I started with Elton John.
Yeah, that's crazy that I can't remember what my first record was. That's insane.
My first record was Paul Simon, Graceland, which actually kind of says a lot about me, because the African beats and stuff and that were always what I liked the most about it, and that's kind of something that if you look through the music that I like the most, a solid beat is the thing that pulls me into music. So I will listen to other stuff. I'll listen to stuff that is more kind of noisy or... that doesn't necessarily rely on a beat, but if it's beat driven, it's probably going to be my favorite thing. So
I couldn't tell you what my first record is, actually, but I could tell you what my first compact disc was, the Space Jam soundtrack. yeah, I stand by it. It's still good. Yeah, still great. Yeah.
Vinyl isn't the be-all, end-all. Having said it, I do think there is some attraction to vinyl. Part of it is nostalgia.
I enjoy the artwork. I enjoy that it's 12x12. I enjoy that you're in physical contact with it. I enjoy that it is... you're paying $20 to $40 or whatever you have to pay for it, but you're getting something. Growing up with CDs and with tapes as much as I did, CDs were fine, but I could never look at a CD and the cost make sense to me. I'm super cheap. It drives my wife crazy. And I could never look at a CD and be like, how is this $22? It is it's three pieces of plastic and paper. And with a record, I can't make that. I can't, that takes a lot. It takes a huge machine that costs $100,000. That for some reason speaks to me, but the size of it is what I like. And I just like collecting things. A lot of people, the answers that drive me crazy, record collectors, while they are our customers, also drive me completely insane, because they say stuff like it's the warmth of the records that's the biggest. Nobody knows what that means, and 90% of the people that say that are listening to it on shitty record players that you can't hear the warmth of the record anyway. And so it's like people like collecting things inherently. That's why we all have stuff.
The only physical medium that has gone up and not down progressively is vinyl. I think a lot of music just, not necessarily like sounds better, but it's just more optimal. Like really, really quiet music, while like you get still like the warm quality that you get from vinyl. Just there's a lot more noise listening to it on vinyl, whereas like a cassette or a compact disc, you don't get any of the noise.
And this is me thinking about how I used to listen to records, because you used to oftentimes have to be tied to your record player. You had to be in the same room. Oftentimes you'd have to have headphones, so you were tied to your stereo with the headphone. And I can remember what you end up doing a lot of the time while you're listening to music is you're looking at this record spinning. And this is something that you don't see with compact discs. You certainly don't have anything even close to it, because at least compact discs spin, even though you're not really seeing it. You have nothing close to it with digital downloads. Meu menino mundo a zombar
I could go down and put on an album and just, it would get me into the mood that I wanted. And it's different albums were different things. If I needed to bring myself up, there were albums I liked. If I needed, if I was angry, if I was just stressed, it was a great way to calm down, deal with issues, deal with problems in my head without drugs, without alcohol. And I kept this, you know, collection of records kept growing.
I think records are great. I think they're a great medium. I mean, I have a bunch. They're just back there. Because I used to have a bunch of records out here and then a big turntable and all that. But there's like a magical quality that it can be all that music just, you know, scratched in vinyl. I think they're great. As a musician, I wish they were easier to just put out so you could put out records, but they cost a lot to do that.
The Beatles, everything revolved around the Beatles, because to me, the Beatles changed everything as far as the music industry was concerned. Prior to the Beatles, artists didn't record their own songs, didn't write their own songs, didn't have any input as to what happened. They would choose what song you would sing. They would decide what was going to be a record, what was going to be a single, how it was going to be promoted. When the Beatles were signed, they didn't want to do other people's songs. They wanted to do their own songs. Before that, nobody was allowed to do that. Not even Elvis was allowed to do that. So they changed a lot, and that just, it was everything to me. I had very young parents, so I was exposed to all the radio of the time. I remember hearing it all. Nothing else intrigued me. My father was a martial arts expert. I couldn't care less. I wanted music. I wanted to play guitar. I wanted to be in a band. I wanted to create stuff. I was in a punk band back in the 80s, and we put out records ourselves. We got them into a couple of countries. We didn't sell anything, or we sold very few. We were kids, we were 20 years old. We were told you can't do it. Well, sorry, when you tell a 20-year-old you can't do it, they're gonna go out and they're gonna do it. Many years later, I've discovered that there are people in Japan or whatever who know who we are or what we are, but it's always been a wonderful thing. Music is just, if you play music, if you create something and you see one person who enjoys it or gets a smile, you can't explain that feeling. It's very cool.
Get high with a little help from my friends. Gonna try.